Get this, two nights in a row. Fun times. I just had so much fun doing this last night, and I've been talking to Jack today, so I figured I could answer some questions that I had yesterday, and I've had a lot over the last week, and also dig further into transcribing and fact-checking Mr. Jack Gardiner, the one, the only, the incredible, the awesome, the outlandish, the ridiculous, the Liverpudlian freak of nature, the Scouse Shred. Hello, Jesse, how's it going? Still not related to Paul Gilbert. so we're going to look at Jack Gardiner today. Also, probably going to talk briefly about Martin Miller, because I've got a Martin Miller transcription that I need to do. This is really just distracting me from going and doing what I really need to do, which is measuring up my walls to work out, what sound panels that I want to install. I'm also toying with the idea of doing a lot more live streams. Being out here in the studio, it's a lot of fun, and I can do this stuff. And if I come on and talk absolute nonsense for an hour every night or half an hour every night, just looking over the news, things that have happened in the guitar scene. Let's take an example of that, right? So I've got a Metal Sucks. Have a look at metalsucks.net. See if anything jumps out as being something that's worth talking about. No, I mean, I always pick the wrong example for this because Metal Sucks, obviously metal-based, and I'm not huge on the metal front. Okay. So no rock or metal made Spotify's most streamed songs of the decade list. Which is interesting because it kind of contradicts some of the other stories that you see about Spotify, at least I'm sure I've seen about Spotify, and that metal is one of the most popular genres. I guess maybe that's as a whole. It doesn't surprise me in the slightest that the most streamed songs of the decade would be metal. Looking at this, the most streamed artists of the decade would be Drake, Ed Sheeran, Post Malone, Ariana Grande, and Eminem. Okay, fair enough. I don't know any of Drake's songs, so I know some of Ed Sheeran's material. Never heard any Post Malone, never heard any Ariana Grande. Of course I know Eminem stuff, but you get the idea. Most streamed female artists of the decade and most streamed male artists of the decade. Of course, that doesn't really change much in the male section because it was male-dominated before. Feminists need to do something about that. Equal representation. If you find yourself listening to a male, you should stop and listen to a female. The most streamed tracks of the decade, Jesus. So Ed Sheeran's The Shape of You is the most streamed track of the decade. That's awesome. I've got a video that I need to put together next week on the subject of streaming and uploading music. DistroKid have reached out to me and they want to do a video together. And I've been thinking about re-releasing my album. But in double form, like a collector's edition version of my album that contains both my vocal rock metal album Out of the Ashes, but also the instrumental mix of that album with more lead guitar and guest solos, one of which features Jack Gardiner, actually. So I'm probably going to do that as a double disc thing to look at the entire DistroKid thing and see how that works and how easy that can be for us. And my initial thought when I said I was going to do that was, Is the business model for DistroKid and websites like that going to go down the pan? And my gut feeling initially was yes, because people don't buy music anymore. I've certainly seen a massive drop in sales of my album. Maybe it's because I'm less relevant than ever, right? But no, actually totally wrong. The more I thought about it is, well, of course not. We're always going to put music out. We're always going to make music. And sure, while we don't expect the music to hit iTunes and sell a lot, this is incredibly important that we get our music on Spotify, right? Because that's how people consume so much of their music. So, anything that is a route to music like that is good. Anyway, so I'll continue looking at this. I don't know any of these songs, but Ed Sheeran is Thinking Out Loud and Shape of You are both in the top streamed tracks of the decade, which is incredible. He's made a lot of money. The most streamed artists of 2019, I mean, the same, apart from you've got Bad Bunny. No idea. Again, no idea. And I guess that's the point of an article like this, you know, highlighting that there's no rock or metal in there whatsoever, which, again, isn't a surprise. I don't know why I would be surprised that I don't see any music in there that I know and/or are familiar with. So, yeah, there we go. That's a little one. Let's take a look over at Ultimate Guitar, and then I will come back and I will check out your comments. And then we'll get onto the Jack Gardner fact check. I'm also going to do a little talk about how I got into transcribing, because that's interesting. How I started working professionally. There's a story, which is cool, right? Let's take a look. You clickbait your title. Devin Townsend explains why he was afraid of Strapping Young Lad. I'm sick of being afraid. Well, hopefully that means he's doing even heavier stuff, though of course his last album was very, very mellow. I really enjoyed it, but you get the idea. So there's a Frank Marino story, Marty Friedman. Green Day's Billy Joe Armstrong forgetting lyrics during a concert and handling it in style. Who cares about this stuff? Okay, here's one for you. This is a great subject for talking, right? So Mark Tremonti named Guitarist of the Decade. Guitarist of the Decade. So not long after the Ultimate Guitar community had voted Mark Tremonti's solo in Alter Bridge's 2013 track Bleed It Dry as the best guitar solo of 2010, the musician was crowned as the Guitarist of the Decade by Guitar World magazine readers. The band wrote through its social channels that Mark Tremonti, Guitarist of the Decade, number one, thanks to our friends at Guitar World and everyone who voted. And Mark wrote in a statement that I can't express with words how grateful, humbled and honoured I am for this recognition. Many of the other guitarists on the list continue to inspire me and I'm so proud to be considered one of their peers. Thank you to all that made this possible. I am forever grateful. This does make me want to talk about stuff. So I know most people are going to look at that and go, "What? How ridiculous. Mark Tremonti, Guitarist of the Decade. Yeah, Mark Tremonti is a good guitar player. He is a good guitar player. He's a great songwriter. I'm a big fan of Alter Bridge. Not as big a fan of the band Tremonti, you know, but what this makes me think of is Billie Eilish talking about or mentioning being caught out for not knowing Van Halen. And it's just really a sign of the times, right? It is what it is. You wouldn't expect Billie Eilish to know who Van Halen are, because Billie Eilish is, what, 17? Van Halen were at their peak before I was born, and their first album came out a decade before I was born. So, you know, like, it's a marvel that I know who Van Halen are, right? But somebody who's 17, you know, people are giving them a hard time for not knowing who Van Halen is. And I love the take that Michael Anthony had on the subject, just highlighting, you know, it's fine that Billie Eilish doesn't know who Van Halen are. There are plenty of people out there that haven't heard Van Halen. You should go check them out. They're a cool band. And likewise, there are tons of people out there that are unfamiliar with Billie Eilish's music. She's a cool artist. You should go check her stuff out. I like that. It's wholehearted. And it kind of makes me think of this. There are always going to be guitarists that you would rather put in the Guitarist of the Decade list over Mark Tremonti. But ultimately, none of this stuff matters, right? It doesn't fucking mean anything. I mean, obviously it doesn't mean anything when Nita Strauss was in the running for it, right? So there you go. There's a little, what would we call that? A preview of what it would be like to hear me talk about whatever bullshit is going on in the week. With the news. So let me read these comments and then we'll talk about some stuff. We'll do some Jack Gardner fact check. So Sergeant Rock says, "Hey Levi." Elio asks if I've checked out Nick Jennison. Nick Jennison also works for Lick Library, so I'm very familiar with his stuff. Miles Holter, Guitar and Music Chat, thanks for your contributions. Contributions to the guitar community, Levi, you rock. Thank you very much, Miles, you rock too. Shadows of Castillo, hello, hello, hello. Jesse says, that song creeps me out, Ed Sheeran in general. I kind of like Ed. I wouldn't say I'm a huge fan, but I like some of his stuff. So fair enough. He perfectly serviceable pop songs, right? Six Shine, greetings from the States. How's it going? Whereabouts in the States? Be more specific. Plan on attending any large concerts this year, Mr. Clay? Yeah, I'm going to see Devin Townsend next week on Monday, which is big for me, I guess. I don't tend to listen to a whole lot of artists that you would consider big, right? So, and also I live in Glasgow, so or just outside of Glasgow, so the access that we have to, you know, big bands like this is not as not sure. Bands do come here, but what you find is a European tour might hit London, might come in north of the border. It's considerably less likely. So I tend to go see smaller gigs, but that's fine, that's fine. Tiffo, hey Levi, long time no chat. Hope all is well, my man. Yes, I am very good. I am doing good. Christian says that Empath didn't really click with me, loved Evan overall. You know, Christian, I feel exactly the same as you. The first time I listened to Empath, it didn't grab me. What really grabbed me was listening to and watching the song Why. And I was in a bit of a down phase. I wasn't feeling my best when I listened to that song for the first time. But I didn't just listen to it, I watched the video. And I think that when you do that, it highlights to me that Devin is very much kind of like Stephen Wilson, in the sense that his music is great, but it's best consumed with video because he can inject so much more emotion into things. So watching the video for Why, listening to the music, when it was sort of a minute or two into the song, I was listening to it with my wife, I kind of thought to myself, man, she's really not going to like this. I mean, is this even really a song or is this a cartoon? But by the end of the song, I don't know, I was captivated. I couldn't take my eyes off the screen. I was smiling and I was having a really good time. And now when I listen to that album, I think of, or when that song plays, I think of that video. And the overall feeling that that particular video gave to me, and the whole album kind of gelled a little bit more. It made a lot more sense to me there. So there we go. Ed Sheeran used to roadie for Nislopi. I don't know what that is, sorry. Luminous, hello. Billie Eilish, I assume, doesn't write guitar music from what you've heard. Can anyone ever really be the best? I talked about this on the Guitar Souls podcast, and for those of you that are unfamiliar with my podcast, please do go and check out the Guitar Souls podcast. There's a video up on my channel of our last thing. Oh, Martin Miller's online. I'm going to be looking at your track very briefly soon. Not transcribing the whole thing, but, you know, just talking about the process, man. Yeah, so no, of course no one can be the best, apart from the times where they can. Music is inherently subjective, but there are many objective things of music that can be analysed, right? So, for example, and it's all sporting things, right? Who can play the fastest? Now, who can play the fastest is a bit broad. You'd have to literally, who can play the fastest on one string? Who can play a three-note string scale ascending? But actually, when you highlight it like that, it sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? It sounds absolutely ridiculous. If you were to say who's the most harmonically advanced, I don't think that's objective because people are going to have different opinions on that. It's going to be different for different people. So of course you can't really have the best. But magazines love writing about the best, right? People love talking about the best. People love to bat for their team, if you like, support their hero, if you like. So yeah. Let's have a look. The Chexican. Hey Levi, just wondering how you decide which notes are correct on the fretboard. For example, how can you tell when an artist plays a note an open A string or the fifth fret of the E string? There are definitely times where you don't know. Generally speaking, you can always tell an open string from a not open string, and you can tell thicker strings from thinner strings. But there is definitely a lot of guesswork involved when transcribing guitar. I prefer to work from video for obvious reasons, but of course, if I can't, it's not a deal breaker. But what I would say is that I'm going to turn my air conditioner on because it's a little bit chilly in here. What I would say is that guitar is a weird one. I had someone contact me today asking me about transcribing some Baroque harpsichord. Very much typical kind of Bach counterpoint stuff. And it was a really nice piece. And the thought of transcribing that is awesome because it will be really easy to do. Because at no point do you have to worry about, well, where is this particular note played? It's only guitar where we have to worry about something silly like that, right? So yeah, sometimes you can't tell, but I guess the most important thing, the Chexican, is that it comes from experience, right? As I play guitar, I have a damn good idea of where something is likely to have been played. Whereas if you could be a master transcriber, but if you are a piano player by trade and you have very little experience playing guitar, it's going to be a lot harder for you to have a put in educated guesses as to where something is likely to have been played. So, yeah, experience is always the answer. Southern US, Atlanta, Georgia. Okay, that's Cameron Allen lives out that way. Yeah. I've not been to Georgia. It's definitely on my list of places to go. I mean, that entire Appalachian area where that you know, like the bluegrass scene really started to pick up and take off, is absolutely somewhere that I feel is, I'm going to say, a spiritual home. I really want to spend more time in that part of the world. So Why is really great. Yeah, the song Why. So what we got here? Absolutely loved your videos on the fake Instagram. They were the most, by far the most concrete of all the ones I've seen. Thank you very much, man. We're going to fact check someone else tonight. We're going to fact check Jack Gardner. See if he's a big old faker. See if he's a big old hypocrite. That's Martin Miller. My good friend. One of my favourite people in the world. Name, surname. Greetings from South Africa. How's it going? And Jeff is online. How's it going? Good to see you, man. Robert Hayes, what's popping, dude? Sergeant Rock, I bought a physical copy of Empath, the first physical copy in quite a while. I hate the thought of enjoying so much of Devin Townsend's music without properly supporting him. That's a really, really interesting comment, and I know exactly where you're coming from. We are consuming less physical media, we are purchasing less physical media, and the way around that for the artist is to offer better physical media, like nice collector's editions of things, and Devin is big on that, right? Devin's very smart when it comes to the business side of music, right? So you are more inclined to spend the money on something, I was going to say unique, but let's say special, than just streaming his albums. But it's impossible. It's impossible to enjoy everyone's music and support them. In the same way that you would like to be able to support them. Become the Knight's fake guitar video was interesting, which he shouted you out a bit. I'm not sure I've seen that one, Randy, but if someone wants to send a link, I'll check that out. A stream with both myself and Martin. I'd be happy to do that. We were talking about doing a video this week, but life got in the way, as usual. Rating guitarists is a stupid hobby. Probably the stupidest hobby. A Wild Miller appears, yep. Cheeto asks, have you checked out the new supergroup Sons of Apollo, Wicked Guitar Work? I have listened briefly to some of it, and obviously I'm a big fan of Bumblefoot, but I don't like supergroups. I don't like supergroups at all. I don't like any projects that Mike Portnoy is involved in. And Billy's on bass, right? It's Billy, Derek Shireni, and Portnoy, Bumblefoot, and who have they got singing for them these days? Scott Stapp. I think Scott Stapp's doing vocals. Could be wrong on that one. Probably wrong on that one. I know they changed singer. Who the fuck did they change singer to? It wasn't Scott Stapp, was it? Let's have a look. Ah, Jeff Scott Soto, yeah. So it was Scott Stapp, and I'm sure it was Scott Stapp. And then Jeff Scott Soto. So we're Jeff Scott Soto now. Yeah, you know, it's cool. There is some cool guitar work. Of course, it was Bumblefoot. Big fan of Bumblefoot, but yeah, no thank you. Portnoy and Billy Sheehan does my head in. They're in just about every supergroup, right? Upside Down, how's it going, man? Martin is the man. Everybody go give some love to Martin Miller. Go and subscribe. I mean, not that I need to tell you to subscribe to him. His channel is like 6 times bigger than mine. Do you have any physical ailments from playing? Stiff fingers, cramps, bloating, tender nipples. Tender nipples. No, I have a bad wrist, and it's from transcribing. You may be able to hear this. You may not. Let's see if this works. I'm going to bring this down here. I'm going to pop my wrist. Ready? There we go. So there's the pain. But nothing serious. What advice can you give to a guitarist who is stuck on what they want to do in the industry? That's a really, really interesting question. And I don't really know how to answer that succinctly. I guess you've got to weigh up what you want to do in the industry versus what's viable to do in the industry. You know, everybody wants to go out and be the superstar standing in the spotlight, but it's hard to do that. It's hard to... We can't all do that. So sometimes you have to take a step back and look at not what you want to do, but what is feasible, where the work is. I know guys that work in magazines that never thought that's where they would end up. But they love it now because they've, not that they've, you know, learnt to give up on their dream, but because they've actually learnt to appreciate the skill that goes into that side of doing things. Obviously, my big business is transcription. I'm very passionate about transcription, and that was very, you know, easy for me to make. But I did have to make that decision to go, well, what would be the smart thing? Where would be the smart place for me to put my energy? And of course, transcription was a smart thing to do because there wasn't a whole lot of competition. But I will be talking about that in a second. Aidan MC, or Add-on MC, studio looks superb. It does look good, doesn't it? And there's Martin again. Tom, any tips on transcribing odd rhythms in guitar solos? And how do you figure out where the downbeat starts? Okay, I'm not going to answer that right now. We will be coming back to that when we do the Jack Gardner thing. Jessica Soto. Again, Duvidas is online. Yeah, that wrist snap was loud. I was going to say get a username that people can pronounce, but to be fair, we've got someone online called Upside Down, and actually, when you try and read his name, it's Umop3Plusden. So, how's it going, man? Oh, okay. Yep, fair enough. That's the Becoming the Night vid. Yeah. Actually, so if you go to that vid and you check out the pinned comment, I am the pinned comment on that video. So, yes. Scott Stapp, supergroup music bitch. So I'm sure Scott Stapp sang in that band. Oh, no, sorry. He was in Art of Anarchy. Art of Anarchy being the other band that Bumblefoot was in. That was a bad band. For anyone thinking of if you want to check them out, was not a fan of that. Don't like supergroups. Are there any exceptions? I mean, of course, there's always exceptions. There are always exceptions to that as a concept. Shit, what what was this fucking Steve Morse Flying Colours? You know, I thought Flying Colours were a really cool supergroup. I just think, generally speaking, when you look at supergroups, very rarely are they better than the sum of their parts. Very rarely. Though, of course, there are always going to be tons of exceptions to that. So, but if people want to list off supergroups, I'm happy to give my opinion on them. Chad Kroger. Have I read the second edition of Improvisers OS? I haven't. Chatroom of Wild Players. Yeah. It's kind of cool. I love the fact that I have all these great players that like to hang out here. I also hate the... I hate the fact that my moustache is constantly getting... what that is. Just... they feel sticky. I hate the moustache. I love it, but I hate it. Learn. Okay, stuff that is hardest to learn but easy and super satisfying to play once you get it, like Nuno Bettencourt stuff. Pascal Grasso, that's a great question. I've transcribed a bunch of his stuff for clients over the years. He's not particularly my cup of tea, but I do appreciate how good he is at what he does. I like a lot more. How would I describe it? Like, I like the unrefined jazz guitar player, the Joe Passers of the world. But he is a great player. There's no avoiding that. The hardest transcription I ever did, so it's got to be some Holdsworth stuff. Various live Holdsworth bootlegs. Who, in my opinion, are some of the best innovators in the guitar community today? Matthias Eklund is great. I'd have to give credit to Matthias Eklund. Yeah, absolutely. I'd have to give credit to Bumblefoot. I think he's been a huge innovator. How much his innovations have impacted the wider scene is up for debate. I would probably argue not much, but I think he had some serious innovations. Over his recording history, he's had some real innovations. So that's the go-to name that I want to go for. Innovators. Yeah, innovators to me means doing new things, right? And credit where credit is due, the whole neo-soul thing is another area. I think guys like although, you know, of course there are many people doing the same sort of thing, but guys like Misha Mansur, I think he's been a huge innovator. He's popularized the sound. I'm not a fan of his playing, but Tosin Abasi is definitely an innovator. He's innovated quite a lot. But I'm just going to go back to Bumblefoot. But I do love Matthias Eklund's playing. Any tips for transcribing heavily distorted guitar where the pitches of the notes are sometimes hard to discern? Yeah, experience. Same basic thing. When I have my parents... I said experience, not Siri. When I have my parents listen to heavy metal or rock or whatever, to them it just sounds like noise, right? And over time, you have to take time to listen to it to understand and hear and separate parts. Your ears get better at hearing it the more you're exposed to it. So, yeah. Now, of course, there are examples that you would transcribe where it is just impossible to hear what's going on. And stuff like that, you do what you can, man. You search up video footage, you look up covers, you try and get as many people's inputs into things, and then you weigh up things against what it's likely to be, and then you're checking against the recording. But honestly, yeah, sometimes it is absolutely impossible. Super late to Bumblefoot, just discovered him. So as expected, your mind was blown. Yeah, I describe Bumblefoot as the untranscribable. Any more stories from bad gigs? Thought my video on it was great. The amount of bad gigs. The amount of bad gigs that I've played. Mainly because I'm playing them. bad gig stories. Bad gig stories. I think of the last Hellcat Molly gig that we did, actually. Because we had announced that it was going to be our last show, and we'd built up a small following in London. We'd certainly sold enough t-shirts that people would come down to our shows, they would drink beer, and they would be wearing our shirts, right? And we got booked onto this, I can't remember who was playing, actually. I'm sure Richie Allen's band might have been playing as well. Richie Faulkner. I can't remember what his fucking band was called now. Not Judas Priest, obviously. So we were booked on this gig, and it was strange because they were alternating. It was a charity gig, and they were alternating between bands and then was it DJs or comedians or dancers? It was dancers. So band dancers type thing, right? And the sound check just went way over what it should have been. There was a guy that I know that was sound checking on that gig, and he just absolutely took the piss. Like, dude, you're in a band that no one fucking cares about, playing a gig, and you're worried about, you know, has your axe effects been properly represented, and you want to run the same song 6 times. Anyway, the gig ended up starting late, and we were on after the... So it was a dancer, then a band, and we were the first band on. So the dancer did her full set, and then we went on, and after 4 songs, the sound man came up to me, and he was like, I've been told that we're cutting your set short, so we can get back on track. And I was like, what? What? You're cutting our set short? What do you mean? Yeah, but we need to cut some time somewhere. And I'm like, dude, look around, right? How many people are here wearing shirts with other bands' names on? So I just did my best to fight with the guy, and it didn't work. Like, I played, it would have been Story of a Wealthy Man, maybe. And then I knew that we were supposed to end, but I just went straight into the song Good Time Girl, which ended up being on my album. And after halfway through the verse, the sound man just cut all of the sound, and I fucking flipped. Absolutely fucking flipped. And that doesn't sound like me, right? But yeah, I absolutely lost my cool, and I'm screaming at this guy going, you're a fucking piece of shit, you know that? That's why you're over there doing the fucking sound that you just do in a fucking pub on the weekends, and I'm up here selling t-shirts to people. People actually here to enjoy my fucking music. Who's praising you? Oh, by the way, everyone sounded fucking shit tonight. You know, we would have been on stage much fucking sooner if you could have sorted the fucking sound out and kept that cunt in line. I was I was absolutely fucking furious because I knew it was important to us. It was like our farewell gig, and so that was it was a terrible gig experience because I lost my cool. So there you go. There's a gig story for you. Not too sure if I've been asked about this. Thoughts on Polyphia? Tim's a great player. Polyphia aren't really my cup of tea, but I do put their last album on from time to time. Beard Game is good, yeah. Have I seen Memo Gardner Fernandez's recent posts on Instagram? So here's a really important thing, Tyler, right? So you say Instagram since the speeding up debacle. You have to meet the claims that are met. I always talk about this. You've got to meet the claims that are met, right? And the claims that are being made against him aren't all that he's speeding things up. Okay, so he's posted three, as you point out, he's posted three videos, not guitar expert. I can't tell if it's comparable and difficult to the accused videos. They're not even close to comparable in difficulty. And here's the most important thing. They're not as fast and they're not as clean. Now, I am actually in the camp of not accusing him of speeding his videos up. I don't actually think he speeds his videos up. I think he records his audio lick by lick, section by section, piece by piece. So you can stitch things together and edit them together into these things that you would never ever be able to play as fast and as accurately as he does in one take. And then, with the pressure off, you do a rough mime over it, and most people aren't going to be able to spot this. I think that's what he does. That's my opinion on that. So to post videos of yourself on stage not quite playing as technically or as clean or as fast, and then going, see, I don't need to speed anything up. It's like, I don't know who you're talking to, man, but you certainly ain't fucking talking to me, because you are trying to dispute a claim that I personally haven't made. So yeah, Guitargate, yeah, I'll be doing this is what I do. Sims Cashin, yeah, great player. Consider the source. That's Gabe Marin. I'm gonna check. Yeah, Gabriel Marin. Yeah, he's a good player. Fretless guy. How do you go about writing a song? That's a tough one. Are you supposed to already have an idea playing in your head? Do you noodle around with scales? I certainly don't think about scales and chord progressions. I play around with things that I think might sound cool, and if I start repeating myself, I try and deliberately I'll play something I like, and then I'll deliberately go in a completely different direction from where my brain tells me I should go. And I'll do that with 10 or 15 different things. Until I find something that I go, oh, that was cool, I liked that. As Christian points out, there's no wrong way to write songs. And I do have people from time to time, this is an odd one to me, they are asking, Levi, can I maybe book some lessons with you and we'll talk about songwriting? And I'm like, I mean, I only have one album of music out there, link in the description, and I wouldn't really know how to teach the songwriting approach, because I actually abandoned all of the theoretical stuff in order to write the way I did there. So my advice in a lesson with someone like that would be just fuck around until you find things you like. Now, that's not a consistent way to write songs. It depends what you're looking to write. You know, I could teach you to write pop songs. I could teach you to write Ed Sheeran type songs. I could teach you to write country songs. Because, you know, if you think of guys like Max Martin or Guy Chambers or any of those guys that are well known for their pop songwriting, the hit machine type guys, it's Roman numeral progressions, and there's a few little chord tricks that you can learn that add a little bit of colour and spice to things, but that's not really the stuff I'm interested in writing. So there you go. Not really overly helpful to you, but it's the answer I'll give. So The Blind Sniper, I've done some light transcription and do want to get better, so I'd love to see some tips on how you approach it. Awesome. So I'm going to pause there and just talk briefly about transcribing and stuff. I'm going to do my ad roll stuff, so just let me do that. The stream is brought to you by my supporters over on Patreon. I actually need to add Brian Hsu to that list. For anyone unfamiliar with Brian's playing, he is a fucking outrageously good guitar player. He played in... he has a Super Mario Bros. thing he used to play, and they played video game music. I don't think he does that anymore, but I remember seeing that when I was younger and thinking, dude, that's fucking, yeah, all right, fair enough, that's very cool. And he's now working with Ubisoft. He works full time for Ubisoft, I believe. He's an incredible guitar player, so we need to add him to that. And of course, you can check me out on Amazon, order any one of my books, just search for Levi Clay. You will find all of my books there. New one out in January, looking forward to that. And I'm going to make reference to Transcribe, which is the piece of software that I use for transcribing. That's worth checking out. And if you would like to purchase Transcribe, there is a link in the description. If you go via that, that's my affiliate link to the program. You pay the standard retail price, but I get like $10 of the sale. So it's always, it's like 25%. So it's a great way to support my channel. If you do want to get better at transcribing, you want to use a piece of software, that is the piece of software that I use. Lastly, the really fun one, I'm just going to bring this up. Grab yourself a TTM shirt, the top tier merch. Sticking it to Lance Benedict. My mother always told me, son, when you're in demand, TTM, take their money. Now you can proudly say, TTM, this tee's mine. And it will certainly be more profitable than suing a washed up con man. TTM, truly thanks, mate. So this is a picture that Lance Benedict posted of me. Levi Clay, extortionist. And I just thought I'd add the Guitar Souls logo on there. Because there's no point suing somebody that doesn't have any money. That's the golden rule of life, right? Don't spend good money chasing after bad, is something I was told when I nearly had to sue someone over getting paid for transcriptions. Don't spend good money chasing after bad. So yeah, if I can sell two of these t-shirts, then it will already make more money for the Guitar Souls podcast than suing Lance Benedict ever would. So yeah, call me an extortionist, fine. I'm gonna profiteer off of that. Okay, so let's just finish these. Dude Man Metal. I'm gonna move this back over here. The jazz gig. Are we talking about bad gigs? Worst gigs? Because I've certainly told a story about my jazz, my first ever jazz gig. That was a disaster. Play some metal, sped up, slow it down. Like Carrie Heinen? I don't know who that is, sorry. Hardest standard to solo over. I don't consider myself the kind of player that solos over standards all so much. The one that instantly jumps into my mind is Stella by Starlight. I hate playing Stella by Starlight because it starts on a minor 7 flat 5 chord, and I'm terrible at playing minor 7 flat 5 chords. So I'm going to go with that. I think it always depends on speed though, right? It's always like how fast are those changes moving by? If you're looking at like bop tunes like Ornithology, that's hard because it's so damn fast. Cherokee is a standard I love to play, but within reason, depending on the speed that you go, that you play at, right? Cherokee can be easy or it can be fucking hard. So yeah, I don't think there's no hardest. You can make something hard if you want. Randy asked, this is a silly question, but have you ever had to transcribe guitar polychords? That would be hard. I assume you're meaning literal voicings on the guitar that are polychords, triads on top of triads, etc. Yeah, all the time. It depends how you think of chords. You could look at something like a G13 flat 9 and think of that as being an E major triad over a G7 chord. So it's a polychord, or you could call it a G13 flat 9. So, yeah. I came at that sound, man. when did I realise that I could make a career out of transcribing? This is a story I'm here to tell. So I will get to that in a second. As a sound man myself, you understand my pain. Thank you, I appreciate the sympathy on that one. TTM shirt, yeah. Guy doing the Benson teaching thing. I came across him in a closed Facebook group selling his course. Seems like a legit plan. Oh yeah, so that's totally true, man. I watched some videos of him playing, that guy selling those George Benson products. He can do the best Benson impression I've ever seen. He's a great player, but he's also trying to charge £600, like £100 per ebook, which is absolutely nuts. Yep, I like that shirt. Martin Miller with the donation, helping out for that lawsuit. Cheers, brother. Let's go. was blasting through these. Martin Miller did donate to me, yeah. I mean, Martin's a good friend. I'm working for Martin right now. I've got to do some damn transcribing for him, so I'll take that €5 off the bill. Stellar is beautiful. That's why I hate it so much. TTM doesn't have the money. Doing transcripts. So Nathan, been doing transcription for years. What's your view on rhythmic accuracy versus readability? That's an awesome question. Seen some transcriptions that look so ugly because they try to get every detail. Couldn't agree with you more, man. I am all about quantizing your transcriptions. You have to understand, I mean, not you, you've been transcribing for years, so you know this, but you get the ethos behind transcriptions. Your goal is to take something that's been played and to write it down so you can give that piece of paper to somewhere and they can you know, recreate that thing. Now, if you go into granular level of detail on that, where you're using all manner of ridiculous tuplets because, oh, well, technically he played that note for a little bit longer than a 16th note, like a ball hair longer than a 16th note, you're not really getting into the world of writing things down that people can read then. You're getting into the world of writing something down that you could put into, you know, some piece of MIDI playback software and get an exact playback thing. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, and it definitely is a skill in its own right, and I have a lot of respect for people that do that, but also at the same time, from the perspective of the client, that's usually useless. So I try to avoid doing that. It makes my job as a transcriber easier. It helps you more often than not to get into the mind of the player. And we're talking about like odd rhythms. If even just thinking someone like Pat Martino that pushes and pulls with his swing feel so much in his lines, you could really try to notate that exactly as is, or you could quantize a little bit and use text to say push and pull, etc. That's going to make the thing a lot easier to read. It's going to make it a lot easier for the person that's playing it to interpret it. So that's always what I prefer to do there. Of course, from time to time, clients want granular detail, so you give them granular detail. So, yeah. David has work in the morning, so you'll catch the rerun. Thanks very much for tuning in, though, bud. Greetings from Mexico, Alejandro. Does changing pitch in transcribe make it harder to learn songs? Don't have many... No, not at all, man. I actually use transcribe for that very purpose sometimes. A perfect example would be the song Hotwired by Brent Mason. So that was recorded in standard tuning, as far as I'm aware, and then in the mix, he pushed it up a semitone because they preferred the sound of it in F. I think it might have been sped up a little bit as well, but when I want to play along to that, I don't want to either put a capo on the first fret of my guitar or have to tune my guitar up a semitone. I just take the Hotwired transcription and pitch shift it down a semitone in transcribe and then practice along to that. So there you go. Did you work on ear training or just have a naturally good ear? I worked on it a lot. Christian's off the bed. Thank you very much for tuning in, man. Appreciate it. Buying transcribe now. Tired of downloading slowdown apps on my Android phone. They just don't work. Thank you very much for using the link, though, Chio. Does transcribe allow you to slow down any song off of YouTube? Well, you have to download the song from YouTube. There are many, many places that you can download it. But yeah, great. Most extended chords omit notes, so I assume you can technically play a polychord by omitting notes. Well, yeah, technically you can, but you know how you choose to name it might be a little bit different. When I say G13 flat 9, and thinking of that as being an E major triad over a G7 chord, the G7 that I'm thinking of wouldn't actually include the fifth, but you know, such is life. Good evening from Sweden. Right, so that's me caught up with comments, hopefully. How do I feel about transcribing ghost notes? Again, it depends on how accurate it depends what the client wants, Fred, is what I'd say to that. Right, so the story of how I got into transcribing. This is a fun one. I've never told this story publicly, and it involves a bit of naming and shaming, and also paying tribute to some people that are no longer with us, etc. So, I started transcribing when I didn't have access to the internet or anything like that, and I didn't have the ability to slow things down. So I was using Windows Media Player, and there were things that I wanted to learn that weren't transcribed. So I thought, fuck it, I'll just try it myself. And working in Windows Media Player was extremely slow. I fart in 68, so I know your real name. It was extremely slow. And the first thing that I ever sat and tried to transcribe was a song by the band Pinkly Smooth, which was Sinister Gates' band before Avenged Sevenfold. There was all this weird... I can't remember the name of the song. I'd have to check it out again. But yeah, I just kind of liked what was going on. I was like, I wonder what that is. Now, that was a terrible thing to do for a first transcription, as anyone that will that has tried to learn to transcribe will know, or they know after time and getting experience in the field. You never, never start. Yeah, very cheap. But I appreciate it. You never start by doing something hard. You don't learn to run before you can walk, type thing. But that was what I started with, and then from there I wanted to do some Linear Sphere. So Linear Sphere is Martin Goulding's band, and also the first album was Charlie Griffiths as well, who's now in Haken. And I transcribed some of their stuff. Again, very slow, painful, right? But the more I got into it, the faster I got at it. And my progress was slow, but it was existent. It did happen. I was getting better at it. Then things really changed when I started to go and see The Fellowship, Guthrie's band, The Fellowship, or Zach Barrett's band, actually, but Guthrie often playing guitar in The Fellowship. So I used to go see The Fellowship in Chelmsford every week. And it was at this point I was really starting to think about what I wanted to do with my career. And I was heavily influenced by Guthrie, and I admired what he did. I admired that he was a transcriber. And I admired listening to him talking about Steve Vai, who also was a transcriber. Now, Guthrie talked about looking at what Steve did, doing the same thing, submitting transcriptions to magazines and things, and managing to find some work. And I thought to myself, that's kind of cool. Maybe I could do something like that. That would be an interesting career. I love writing music down. So I started to take that side of things a little bit more seriously. So when I did that, what I did is, well, I want to learn things that aren't being written down, and Guthrie was a big influence. So I was transcribing Fellowship bootlegs, and I was transcribing the Erotic Cakes album, because that had been floating around on the scene for years beforehand on cassette tapes that used to be passed around when I was in college. But yeah, I started transcribing Erotic Cakes because I wanted to have an understanding of how he was doing the things he was doing. I wanted to understand it. So I transcribed most of the Erotic Cakes album. Cool. Now, word got around that I had transcribed that album, and everybody wanted it. Right, cool. I also know that Guthrie, from, you know, spending time talking to him, is very much not a, like, give all of my stuff away kind of guy. So I was actually trading the tabs with people for other bootleg things. So Guthrie bootlegs, I was fond of that. Like any rare bootleg type things, anything that people could offer, I was happy to trade the stuff. I just wanted to not have it go too public because I didn't want Guthrie to be upset by it. And then Martin Millam, if he's still online, he might be able to remember this. Back on the Petrucci forum, I was never a member on the Petrucci forum until much later on. They were closed for registration for a very long time. And someone in college who was on the Petrucci forum sent me a thread, and it was a thread about me. And people were saying, there's this guy, Levi Clay, he's transcribed the whole Erotic Cakes album, but he won't share it with people. And yeah, that upset me, actually, because there was a reason why I wasn't doing it. It was out of respect. But as I was reading these comments, people started being really quite unkind about me. And that was never the intention. Never the intention. I never wanted to come across as that way. Like, obviously, I'm always about helping people. I can assure you, this stream won't make money. I'm doing it because if I can help people in any way, then that's awesome. So after reading that thread, I thought to myself, well, I'm not going to be lambasted by people out of some, I'm not going to say misplaced sense of respect for Guthrie, but maybe unnecessary respect. I'm sure he certainly wouldn't want me to be a bad guy for trying to be a good guy. So I posted them all publicly. I posted them on scribd.com. And actually, I can probably check those now. Let's have a look. Sign into Scribd. Sign in. Where would these be? Document uploads. They get deleted. Well, they're not there. I think, did I take them down? They might be under an old Scribd account. It could very well be under maybe Miss Mystery. Yeah. Anyway, I may have taken them down. But point is, after a few weeks, these tabs, word got round, and they were getting thousands and thousands of views, downloads, like 40,000 views and downloads each. And I was like, Jesus, that's insane. That's absolutely insane. And a few weeks later, I got my first email from somebody saying, I saw your transcriptions. I was wondering if you'd be able to transcribe this Richie Kotzen solo for me. Let's say Richie Kotzen solo. I did a lot of Richie Kotzen in the early days and Greg Howe. And I was like, yeah, I mean, I guess I could do that. Sure. And the guy was like, I mean, I'd pay you. And I was like, okay. And he was like, he said, how does, you know, $20 sound? And I'd never really thought about making money from transcribing like that, but I went, well, okay, cool. I was still at university at the time. So I was like, okay, cool, I'll do that. Sure, no problem. Okay, now I'm gonna name drop. So the guy's name was Jason Macedo. Jason Macedo. There's a huge story behind this guy. He's one of those, I'm not going to say cult, but he's very known, especially on the Sean Lane scene. I got chatting to Jason from that, and he told me that he was a transcriber himself, but he was very busy and he didn't have time to do this, that, or the other. And there were things that he was interested in learning that he didn't want to do, so would I be willing to do them, etc., etc. And then he started saying, well, I've got this friend and they want this. Would you be able to do it for them? And I said, yeah, of course, no problem. I can do that, sure. I'm just going to deal with these super chats. So Sergeant Rock says, quality content, thank you very much. Put this towards your next Gibson purchase. I do actually want to add another Gibson to my collection. I do want to get an SG. I had an SG and I miss that guitar very much. And James Shackelford says, can you transcribe jazz guitar? Absolutely, of course. And can I do a Grant Green album? Of course I can do a Grant Green album. This is actually quite poignant because when I was on Scribd just there, I'm sure one of the few uploads that I do have on there, this was a university project that I did. We'll come back to Jason Macedo in a second. I did, there's four transcriptions on there of All the Things You Are. There's a transcription of Borelli Loren, his playing on All the Things You Are on Acoustic Moments. Martin Taylor's transcription of All the Things You Are from the album Solo. Tal Farlow's transcription of Tal Farlow's solo on All the Things You Are from the This Is Tal Farlow Best Of CD. And then there's a Grant Green solo of All the Things You Are. So I wouldn't be my first Grant Green. Would not be the first. I can do absolutely anything, James. If you hit me up via email, we can talk about your needs and we can sort things out. Anyway, so Jason Macedo. He started hooking me up with all of these people that wanted transcriptions. And I wasn't getting paid a lot, but, you know, a university student who was trying to make ends meet. So I... I think you can actually put even more money in on Super Chats than that, Randy. I've certainly seen like friends of mine, like Count Dankula, get those $500 Super Chats all the time. It happens, especially when he does a birthday stream. So, sorry, what was I saying? Yeah, Jason Macedo. So he was getting me to transcribe for a lot of his friends, and that was cool. That was fine. And then he started to phone me every day. Every day he would Skype me and we would talk shit for an hour, then 2 hours. And Jason is your classic Dell boy, right? He would float, you know, I'm going to start this website, I'm going to do this. I've got a website called the Six String Squad. Do you want to be a teacher on it? You know, I'll help you learn to video yourself and stuff like this. And the guy did help me out. He certainly did help me out. He hooked me up with a camera and taught me how to video edit. I mean, it was a terrible camera, but, you know, this is going back years, and I appreciated that. And the Six String Squad never happened, but then he launched a magazine called The Sound Guitar Magazine. And if you go back to the first couple of issues of that, I was like a primary contributor to that. It was like my first experience of writing magazine style stuff. And there was talk of, you know, this is going to be the next big thing. It's going to, but it was. I very quickly realized it absolutely was never going to be the next big thing because Jason. I'm not going to say he was illiterate, but his ability to proofread and his ability and grasp on the English language was dreadful. His ability to design and lay out a magazine was appalling. People would submit pictures for the magazine, pictures of themselves, and the picture might be this size, but the box that it needed to go in was this size. So rather than, you know, cropping the picture, he would just squash the picture into it. It looked fucking awful. And he was so much more interested in trying to sell advertising in the magazine than he was in improving the magazine. But I stayed with them for a couple of issues, and I got to know some guys from that. A notable name would be the gentleman Jason Spell. Some of you may have known Jason. He's no longer with us. He killed himself a couple of years ago. Jason was another prolific transcriber. And what I got to know from Jason and from all Jason Spell and from all of these people that I've met since is that actually Jason Macedo had this racket going. It was a scam, if you like, that he had going on. So he had his own transcription business, and what he was actually doing, he couldn't transcribe. He was dreadful. But what he was doing is he was finding all of these other young guys that could transcribe. He was paying them peanuts to do these transcriptions for him, and then he was trying to sell them to people. And even a couple of months ago, actually, I had someone reach out to me from the Sound magazine, a guy by the name of Tyler, a proper snake in the grass type email, where he asked about transcribing some stuff for him. And then he eventually fessed up that it wasn't for him at all, it was for Jason, and Jason was trying to get into my collection. Jason, just a nasty, nasty piece of work, and he took advantage of a lot of people. But the blessing, if you like, was, well, there were two blessings. Three blessings. One, that was when I was introduced to Vinny at VPix. You'll see the VPix logo up there. And I've worked with Vinny ever since. Two, I got to know more clients. So that was helpful. People would reach out to me about transcribing. And then three, probably the most important, it taught me that there are people out there in the music industry that will seek to take advantage of you. And it is our job as self-employed people to be aware of this stuff and to not let people do that to you. And if you need to be an asshole to someone about it, if you need to, you know, fight for yourself, stick up for yourself, there's nothing wrong with that. You absolutely stick up for yourself. So that's when I kind of learned to fight for myself a little bit. And obviously I've become quite a fighter over the years. So those are all important lessons, but I guess what I'm getting at is what came from that was more confidence in my ability as a transcriber, that it's okay for me to transcribe things for people. And after that, well, after I'd done all of that stuff, well, Martin Goulding, who was a teacher of mine at the time, he started giving me teaching work on various residential courses. And I got to know guys like Andy James. I reached out to guys like Tom Quayle, and I got to know a few guys from the Sound magazine where... you know, I would essentially just be like, dude, look, you've got all this great music out there. I can transcribe it for you. I could transcribe it for free if you want, and we could sell the product, and then maybe you could give me a small cut. Or alternatively, if you just want to pay me a fee up front, I'm happy to do it, and then you can sell it, and you will make money. You know, I used to have business cards that used to say, unlock the profits in your publishing. Because that's exactly what it was. It was about making artists money. Andy James wasn't selling tabs before I came along, and then I put him in a position where he could do that, and he's made a lot of money selling tabs. And same with Tom Quayle and the like. So it became about meeting new people and saying, well, look, I've got a skill. You've got stuff that could easily be turned into product. Why don't we work together on this, and you can make more money from the thing that you've already done? Currently, the product's already there. It just needs someone to put it together. And you've got fans. You'll be giving them, you know, they're happy. It's not like you're prying money out of their wallet against their will. You're providing them with something that they want. They give you money. And you know what I mean? So, yeah, from that Jason Macedo experience, you can look this guy up online. He's not very well liked in the Sean Lane scene. But, yeah, that was... that was how I got into it, and then, you know, more and more artists turned into more and more jobs, and now I, almost 10 years on, my emails, they never stop. I've had several emails today about transcription jobs, and I'm fine with that. I'm absolutely fine with that, because I love transcribing. So that's the story of how I started transcribing and why I started to take things seriously. Also, whilst I was at university, you know, I wanted to really delve into the content. Like when we were talking about the Grant Green, All the Things You Are transcription, I did that because I did all those All the Things You Are transcriptions because we had to solo over the song All the Things You Are. And most of the guys in my course were just like, okay, cool, so we've learnt our arpeggios, I'll just play the arpeggios over it. Whereas I was a lot more like, well, I mean, I can learn more than that. I can really try and understand what people were playing over these things. So I did that. That's the story of how I got into transcribing. I'm just going to read these last comments, then we're going to get on to Jack Gardner. So, fake playthroughs, high IQ. When his mandates with Guitar Mates coming back, it'd be cool if you could get Daniele Gottardo and Andre Nieri, both friends of mine. I guess that's possible. It's possible. Especially now I've got the studio set up. It's something I'd like to get back to. There's a bunch of people that I'd like to hook up with to do these types of things now. So we'll see where that goes. Speaking of people no longer with us, do I know exactly what happened to Michael Caswell, how he passed away? He was on holiday in... where was he? He wasn't in Lanzarote. But he was out swimming and he got caught in an undercurrent and he got dragged under and he hit his head on a rock. That was very surprising. That was... Me and Mike weren't particularly close and we'd had our battles, if you like. but actually, Michael Caswell passing away actually hit me really hard. I was very surprised by that because it makes you remember. It suddenly makes you realise that, you know, all of the banter and the being short with each other on things and being dicks to each other, ultimately none of it really matters and we're all just people with families. So that was a shame because Mike was a great player. Right, let's keep going. What's the law around transcriptions? What are you allowed to do and not do? That's a great question, Grant. I don't own the transcriptions that I do. When I transcribe something, it is owned by the person that wrote the music. You can only copyright a piece of music once, which is why I don't have... When you go on LeviClay.com, you can't just see everything that I've ever transcribed and say, I want that, I'm going to buy that, I want that, I'm going to buy that. You do see people doing that, and it's highly illegal, but I will never do that because it violates the copyright of the original content provider. Now, some people might look at the situation and say, well, surely if I contact you and get you to transcribe something for me, surely you're violating that copyright. And some people would argue that. I wouldn't. I actually don't even see it as me selling the transcription. I see it as me selling my time, in the same way that if you came to me for a guitar lesson and said, hey, I'd like to learn Smoke on the Water, I wouldn't turn around and say, well, I don't own that, so technically I can't teach it to you. You know what I mean? So, that's what you can do and that's what you can't do. It's best to just work with people, license content and put material out. But, you know, I'm happy to do things for students and clients. Confession, you really love my beard and my hair. I look fucking cool. Thank you very much. What's been the hardest song? It's Alan Holdsworth. Always Alan Holdsworth. Always Alan fucking Holdsworth. Write a book about my story. I've written too many books. They were a dull moment. Who transcribed Tell What Smells Like... I mean, I can transcribe it for you. And Harmony Central, that takes me back. Harmony Central is the best way to learn to play every one of your favourite songs incorrectly. When I was younger, that website would be mxtabs.net. And there's a story for you. Well, not really a story. It tells you who I was, my identity, if you like. I was on mxtabs and my username was Noodles is the King. Noodles is the King. After Kevin Vassaman of The Offspring. Is it Kevin Vassaman? I'm sure that's his surname. Because when I started playing, I was super, super into The Offspring. I still love The Offspring. There you go. How long are the Patreon $50 tier private lessons? They are an hour long, Zero. An hour long. For anyone interested, I will just bring that up. So, $10 credits roll gets you access to gets you on that credit. So $20 study club gets you access to my monthly study club stream, which is like a private stream like this that I do for just study club and above guys. And we look at a book or a DVD or whatever, and we talk about the content in it and how you go about developing it and practicing it. And I often will transcribe, you know, if I'm looking at a Joe Pass video, I will transcribe bits from it and then show you how I work those things into my own practice routines. So that's really about learning how to practice. And then if you're at the $50 tier, you get a 1 hour private lesson with me once a month. So there you go. Oh, How did you go from being a transcriber to being a career criminal? Came into contact with Lance Benedict. how much to transcribe tab? Can't find my way home. Clapton from Hyde Park. For Clapton stuff, it tends to be lower than my standard rates. You're probably looking at like £16 per minute of audio. Well said, Levi. Proud of everything. Everything done after the sound. I don't agree with everything I said. Good luck with the rest of the work. Really enjoy all your videos. You don't. I mean, I see the word. I see the word Macedo in there. So, I. If the word Macedo is in there, you're probably never going to agree with everything I said. But the beauty of me telling a story like that is they're widely verifiable, and I can reach out to, I can get many people to corroborate all of these stories. The cringe of sitting on fucking Skype with Jason and his wife at the time, Crystal, and it was like witnessing domestic or at least emotional abuse. Constantly, and you're just like, what is fucking happening here? What? That guy's off his fucking rocker. And actually, more on Jason. Utter fucking egomaniac, much like myself. He used to constantly, like, when I was like, dude, I'm fucking done with you. Like, there is no fucking business relationship that be had between us. Don't ever burden my fucking email inbox with your name again. I will never do anything for you. I don't need you to do the things that I want to do in life. He went through this long period where he tried to convince, he's just a compulsive liar. He was like, oh, I've quit transcribing now. My rich uncle died and I'm actually a multimillionaire now and I've bought a strip club. Like, okay, mate, cool. Because I think that in his mind, there was very much, if you say something like that, suddenly everyone would come crawling back to him. And then years later, it was like, oh, I've actually got cancer now. And like, I don't want to laugh at someone who might have actually had cancer. But the problem with the Boy Who Cried Wolf story is that you can't trust someone that lies over and over and over again. So there we go. Am I a fan of Ariel Posen? Absolutely. I don't like Slayer. 1 minute 30 solo, so you'd probably be looking at probably £20-25. Do I find solos that are done with really distinct styles harder or easier to transcribe? Totally fucking depends. Okay, I'm going to get on with the actual job because that's why we're here. Let's fact check Jack Gardner. So I'm looking at the Prowling Blues improvisation. This is him improvising over, I'm pretty sure it's a jam track, central track. Sounds like this. I'm going to mark out the file in Transcribe using Transcribe on the top left, Guitar Pro on the right. You can download Transcribe. You can purchase a copy. There is a link in the description. It's not my software. I'm just proud to plug it. It is a piece of software that I use day in, day out. I could have an affiliate account with Guitar Pro, but I'm not interested in trying to sell their product because while it is something I use, it's not something that I would stand behind and say, this is the best piece of software that you could buy. Whereas Transcribe is a must-own piece of software. You must own this piece of software. So I do have an affiliate link in the description. Purchase it via there, and it's a way to support the channel. So I'm going to hit play. I'm going to mark the file out. Thank you. What a great player. So, what do we think? Is it faked? Do you think he's faking this? Of course he's not. Jack Gardner doesn't need to fake anything. Every single note that you hear there is a one live take. And that's what improvisers do. They play one live take. Is there a way on Guitar Pro to have a certain bar with two guitar parts? I can only find multi-view, which shows all. Yeah, you use these buttons up here. Voice 1 and voice 2, voice 3, voice 4. And then you can select multi-voice, so you can see all of the voices like that. One thing about Henry Kaiser, I do get it. Everything he plays sounds so fucking bad. It bothers me to the point that I feel pain when I listen to his stuff. Oh boy, what's up, Dario? Would you do a video of the fingerboard with the tabs on that solo so I can see it as well? Wouldn't mind paying $50 when I can pay. Ruben, what I'm going to say to you is shoot me an email at leviclay88@gmail.com, or you can just contact me via my website, leviclay.com, and we can talk about your needs. You know, I'll do what I can. Yeah, the look of disgust on my face. Jack is so fucking good. There's just no... In fact, I'm going to send him a message now. See if we can get him in the chat. You are being fact-checked on YouTube as we speak. See if he comes online. I'm looking forward to seeing Jack, actually. He's over here. What day is he over here? Is it the 13th? He's over on the 13th? Oh, no, that's something else. Fuck, when is he over? 14th. He's over on the 14th of December. So I'm going to go and hang out with my boy Jack. My boy Jack Gardner. Any hints on how to play like Levi Clay? Don't practice. Transcribe all the things that you hear and never practice to play any of it. Ruben, absolutely no rush. You know, I've got plenty of stuff on. We can talk about things, and often I do talk to people about work that they want doing, and then they never come through and do it. I don't mind. Like, you know, it's part of the job. I'll just be able to give you much more direct answers. When is the video with Martin Miller coming out? I don't know if we're going to do that video. I think we need to do something else, because we're both sick of this fake guitar thing. I say as I go online and show you people who either are or are not fake. I just finished my new t-shirt. I'm working on a I Am The Law t-shirt. I'm not a lawyer, I am the law. Anyway, let's take a look at this. Right, so. So I'm going to mark the file out. I'm going to subdivide by 4 because each measure has 4 beats in it. I'll zoom in a little bit just so I can see a little bit better. So I'm going to put a swing feel in because it's definitely got that swing feel. Da, 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 da. Whoops. Now, of course, open E. Why can I not hear this? Sweet, I'm going to have to close that and reopen it. Because Guitar Pro is a quality piece of equipment that never fucking works. Save that. Reopen it. Transcribe, on the other hand, must own. I've just seen that Rev in the background, and I was talking to Kyle over at Rev today about getting a new amp, and I need to disappoint him, unfortunately. I need to hold off on getting a new amp for a couple of months. It will come, though. Who doesn't need an amp with their face on it? There we go. You should be able to hear that. Yeah, that comes through. Right. So, back to transcribing. Let me just check comments, actually. Stay Metal Ray is online. I am good, man. Hope you are well. That was LeviClay88@gmail.com. Yep. Two guitars playing separate parts, and say halfway through the page you show both guitars, but nowhere else on the page. No, you can't do that, Grant, and it's one of the limitations of this piece of software. Me and Jack kicking it. Pixar, it didn't happen. Okay. Here's last time. Oh, you can't see that, can you? Damn it. My boy. Oh, I've known Jack for too long now. I've known him since he was a boy. I'm a fair bit older than Jack, aren't I? Any tips to improve rhythm notation? Yeah, so we're going to do this now, William. And there's, Stamer or Ray. Right, let's keep going. So, it's all about rhythmic interpretation, right? If we listen to this, just the first two beats. I don't believe in trying to write things out and then play that and copy it and make your MIDI sound like that. That's not how you go about transcribing. You listen to it, you understand the pulse. That's important. But it's actually double that. Bum, ba ba da da. That's just our intro, right? Dum, ba ba da da. There's our rhythm. Bum, ba ba da da. Bum, ba ba da da. Now, because I've processed that internally, I can do it slower. Bum, sorry, bum, bum, ba da da. Bum, ba ba do ba da. I could just do the first beat. Bum, bum, bum. Now, it's not about pitching, it's about rhythm, right? It's about understanding the rhythm. So just dealing with beat one, we just have one note, and it's on beat one. Bum. So I'm going to put that in. If you want to be really pedantic, Jack really does sort of like this. The second beat, we start on the and of two. One and two and three and four and bum. Bum, ba, da, da. More eighth notes. So. You can be really pedantic and say he puts vibrato, but I don't. He doesn't actually pull off there, that is, but he does pick both of those. We could be pedantic again, you could put an accent on there, but not details that I like to include, to be honest. For a guitar player who has been playing for 10 years looking to learn theory, what resource would you recommend? Guitar, music theory, books? It's a tricky one, man. Part of me wants to say a teacher. Because the important thing about a teacher is you can ask a question and get an answer. With a book, you can't ask a question and get an answer. With a book, you can read a chapter and think you understand it, but you don't have someone there to say, actually, no, you don't understand it. But there are lots of great books out there. Of course, I'm going to recommend the Fundamental Changes stuff because I write books for Fundamental Changes, and I know Joseph's standard for releasing books is very high. But intervals and chords are built, but... The advice of r/musictheory is fair, but again, without guidance, it can be tricky. Ba 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 ba. Now I'm going to process this as like an offbeat triplet. Ba ba. Sorry. Ba 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 da da. Da 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 da, which is da 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 da, but with a rest at the start instead of ba 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 ba, we have ba 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 ba. Now I've read the rhythm a million times, so when I hear it, it's much easier for me to write it. Now Jack's a little bit lazy with it; he's slow. He pulls the rhythm a bit. Of course, I teach. Yeah, link in the description. You can either join me on Patreon for private lessons. Or you can email me and do private lessons that way. So this is definitely quantizing. You could... as you just playing top and bottoms there. Very dynamically interesting. Ba, 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 ba. So we're going to hold this. We could put the whammy bar vibrato. One, two, and triple. One, two, dum, ba, bum, ba, bum, ba, da. Ba ba da triple triple ba ba da. So I'm thinking about rhythms. That's just going to be triplets, alright? Triple 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 triple. Yeah. Was I born with a good ear? No, man, I was so damn slow. here's a funny story, actually. I failed oral and transcribing class at university. I failed... tell a lie. I got 41 out of 100 in one of my classes, and a failing grade was 40. The slightly bigger detail there is that 80% of the year also got below a failing grade, and it ultimately came down to the whoever marked them didn't understand how you mark things. Their marking was terrible. Their ability to mark was terrible, and you tend to find that in music school, incompetent teachers that have no concept of actual music. They just need a fucking job. I remember being sat in oral and transcribing class and being taught modes by a singer. Didn't play any instruments, she was just a singer. And she sat and told us about Mixolydian Sharp 1. Mixolydian Sharp 1. What fucking use is Sharp 1? Can you imagine someone playing a scale and saying, well, what mode was that? Did you spot the Sharp 1? It's the stupidest thing I've ever fucking heard in my life. Anyway, so I almost failed that class. And I was working professionally as a transcriber at the time, though, so who knows. My Tom Hess videos, lawyers, mate, lawyers. I might think Tom Hess is a hack, but he's a hack with money. Ba-da, ba-ba-da. Does that pull off? Ba ba ba. Doesn't play that. Ba 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 ba. Ba ba. Ba da da. Ba da da. Triplet. Ba ba ba. So we're going to quantize hit this. I'm going to put that as a ghost note because he does play it, but it's not massively prevalent. Love these faux slide things. What have we got here? Comments. Biggest benefit as a guitar player when transcribing by actually writing it down versus simply learning on the instrument without ever writing it. I can go back to it. there are a lot of wrong transcriptions out there. That's like Aeolian major natural six. Aeolian major. Yeah, I see what you've done there. Can I briefly explain what you said about him? I never saw your videos before you deleted them. I'm really curious about it. If the law allows it. I mean, I can say whatever the fuck I want. The whole point with the Tom Hess thing is I shouldn't need to say this stuff. you should be able to go and look at the way he markets stuff, and his ability as a player and his ability as a teacher, in my opinion, is severely lacking. I don't think he's that good a player. I think he's one-dimensional in terms of the content that he teaches. He markets to your insecurities as a player. It's funnel marketing. It's not about personal relationships with students. And he doesn't have a high success rate with his students. His students don't go on to become world-class players. Like, that's just the way it is. His students go on to join his teaching organization. Some people would have a name for something like that, where you have someone at the top and then people below them and then people below that and people below that. Well, I mean, I 41 to my job. It was my job at the time. I shouldn't have been a 41. It was really just making light of how bad music schools are. That's a video I could do. Change your pickup there if you want. He's a classic email spammer, and I actually have an email saved of his that it wasn't sent to me, but I've always found this absolutely fucking hilarious. This was sent to Richard Duarte. You're probably familiar with his playing. He is absolutely fucking phenomenal. one of the most terrifying players that I've ever met. Hey Richard, your lack of scales mastery is limiting your guitar playing, and so is your lack of arpeggio and chord mastery. Listen, I'm not intentionally trying to make you feel bad. I mean, you definitely are. Let's not pretend this is a personalized email. This went out to every single person. You just plug their name in, and it's just all just automated. About your guitar playing, I'm simply trying to bring to the surface everything that you know deep down is true. So trying to create that sense of inadequacy in people. And I can solve your problems. But you either don't know how to fix it or have been too lazy in the past to fix it. The first step to fixing anything is admitting to yourself that you have a problem and that problem is hurting you. You may have learned your chords, scales and arpeggios. You may even be able to play them very well. But that's not the point. The point is you may think you know these, but you don't. And I'll prove it to you in 2 minutes. Grab your guitar and meet me. Imagine sending that to this guy. Delete his YouTube. I know he had a hell of a hard time with haters on his YouTube channel. Imagine sending that to this guy. Which one of these is going to be ridiculous? I mean, all of his playing is fucking ridiculous, to be honest. He's one of the most ridiculous guitar players. He genuinely is. Let's click this because it's a bit longer. I mean, that's not, I wouldn't describe any of that as tasty, but thank you. Imagine sending an email in all seriousness to someone like that, telling them that they don't know their scales and arpeggios as well as they think they do. What a fucking clown. Yeah. I teach local kids to play guitar, and I joke, I can only get you as good as I am, and it's up to you to be better, and then teach me everything I didn't teach you. I like that. Yeah. Richard's, yeah, seriously, great player. Anyway, let's keep going. I fucking hate having to do this, but I'm going to do it. I'm just going with that. I'm actually going to put that in there as well. It'll play better if you do it like that. You actually are all familiar with Richard's stuff, you just don't know it. If I go... Have y'all seen these? All of those ARF videos, amazing rare footage videos, those are all Richard. Richard does all of those. Yeah, as you can see, he eventually started uploading videos on there of his own face. I mean, he's a serious player. I've not seen this. Let's just check this out. We'll be right back. Again, imagine saying someone like that needs to learn their scales and arpeggios. Start singing what you play is step one. Absolutely, yeah. You have to sing everything that you play. So this will be. That's kind of cool. I love this chord that he plays. Plays the 10 there. Are those videos new to you guys? He honestly has done some ridiculously funny ones of those. imagine how upset this made Alan Holdsworth fans. That backing track sounds familiar. Funny as shit, man, and you look through the comments and it's like cut the crap. Oh no, okay, so this that one's he gets it. There's lots of people that just didn't understand. I was the engineer on the show at Yoshi's. What's up with the post-production noise and sync problem? Like, you were the engineer on this show and you can't understand that this is someone playing something over the top to make it look like it's happening at the original thing. That was really funny. What else has he done that's really funny? Steve Vai playing Legend of Zelda. Zach Sackwell playing George Benson. Comedy gold, absolute fucking comedy gold. George Benson plays Joe Satriani. Look at the downvotes on it. When he was making these videos, people got so fucking offended by them. They just downvoted all of his stuff to shit. And he's so talented to do something like that. It's so much fucking work. Steve Vai's transcription. I mean, Steve Vai is one of the daddies of transcription. He was one of the guys that made me start taking things really seriously. So. It's So I don't need to worry too much about making sure that all of these bar, or, you know, the bar stuff is accurate. You can interpret this, you can look at this transcription, and you can totally do what Jack does. Now, I love this. This reminds me of Martin Miller, who we were talking about earlier. Ba 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 da ba da da ba. Ba da ba ba. Ba ba da da da. Where are we? Dun tipple. Ba ba da da da. Diminished. Fucking mouse, I need a new mouse. If someone wants to super chat me $50, that'd be fantastic right about now, so I can buy a new mouse. This mouse is fucking shot to shit. Every time I try and click with it, it double clicks. Not you though, Connor. How's it going, man? Chris, yes, I am online. Do I sleep? I do sleep. I sleep until like midday. So, do I think, this is a great question from Jevon. Do I think it's worth transcribing whole songs or only solos? I think it's worth transcribing the bits you want to learn. You don't even need to transcribe full solos. Just transcribing the licks that you like. You can listen to this Jack solo and like this lick and just transcribe that and you'll get value out of that. That'll be worth your time. So. Ba, ba. It's Martin, isn't it? Now, I say that, you know, Pat Metheny does this. Ba ba da da, ba ba, ba ba da da, ba da da, ba da. Ba da ba ba. So you see the approach: sing, write, sing, write, sing, write. I'm a wizard, just conjure up a new mouse. I'll be using my Patreon money this month to buy myself a new mouse because this thing, it breaks my heart because this is a Razer mouse, you know, this should fucking last. And I've had it like, I don't know, 3 or 4 years and it's shot to shit. Besides the actual solo, do you also figure out the chords? That always depends on what it is I'm trying to learn, Chris. It's also worth pointing out that, of course, like I'm transcribing this for you guys. This isn't a job for a client. I'm doing this for your entertainment, and I will be posting this on my Patreon page for my transcription challenge, guys. So if you want to download the tab, that is a way to get that. I'm not transcribing this to learn it, and I'm not doing it for a client. So nobody tells me that the chords need to be in there, and I'm not transcribing it because I take particular interest in any of the vocabulary. Though there of course is some very cool vocabulary in here. If it was something that I was looking to actually transcribe, then I would... then I would look at the harmony beforehand, because that's going to be important, right? But some clients, they're not actually that important. They're not the fast part. So. Ba-da. Ba-ba. Nice. Ba 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 da, ba 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 da. Ba ba da ba. That's how you do this stuff. Ba ba da ba. I hear it once, I've got the pitch. Ba ba. Ba 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 ba. That's a great question about key signatures. So, of course, this is E minor, so I might want to put a G major key signature on this. But then for a line like this that we're thinking of being E diminished, you might want to go through this and deal with enharmonics. So you might look at this and say, where we go, so here, where we've got an A sharp in there, enharmonically, that's more likely to be thought of as a B flat. I'm more likely to think of that as an A flat, and as I go down here, C sharp I'd be okay with. This is a chromatic descent. I would probably do that because it's the same thing but moving down chromatically. This would be fine, and then we're back to diatonic here. Anything else that I would change in that? Yeah, no. I'd probably make that. Whoops. Yeah, I'd probably do it like that. Enharmonically, just to fix the enharmonics in there. So there you go. Very cool. You should retranscribe the whole Cherry Lane bass series. I have about 20 books. Helen Keller transcribe is so bad. Yeah, it's funny. Old transcription books are like that, man. Ba 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 da. Ba 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 ba. There's that line. You had a mate record you a short solo for a song. He doesn't remember what he did. He just put the back on and went at it. If I want that transcribed, could I do it? Yeah, absolutely. No problem. No problem whatsoever. Transcribing like you are doing has gone decently for me, but you have such a hard time deciphering timbres of other instruments and then bleeding together. Yeah, that's an experience thing, man. I always go to the example of bass guitar, right? When I first started learning the instrument, I didn't know what bass guitar sounded like when I first started transcribing. Well, maybe at that point, but you know, early on in my playing life, when I was learning Metallica songs or whatever, if you'd said, you know, sing the bass line to this song, I'd be like, what do you mean? And I'd just sing the guitar part and then hope I'm right. You have to learn to understand what a bass guitar sounds like to be able to pick it out of a recording, right? So how about the old Wolf Marshall transcription books, Randy Rhoad tribute? Some of Wolf Marshall's stuff was terrible. Some of it was okay, but some of it was terrible. I do not have perfect pitch. I have good relative pitch. I do not sing. I sing backing vocals in Hellcat Molly, but I wouldn't consider myself a singer by any stretch of the imagination. I don't think any of you would want to hear me sing, so I'm gonna not do that. Oh, look at that. Limited or no ads remain on my Guitar Souls podcast video. Love that. Comments, fine. Yeah. I love that YouTube emails me to say, now live on your channel. No shit, Sherlock. I know that I'm live on my own channel. You don't need to email me to tell me I'm live. Guess who put me live? You can contact me via my website, leviclay.com, or you can email me at leviclay88@gmail.com. There's the double click again. But... now this is problematic, and this comes in with that. This comes in with that quantizing thing. Here he's not actually playing these swung; he is playing these straight. I don't want to put a straight marker in just for that one bit, but they are straight, so I might put like straight there. Do I spell that right? But then he's straight back into the swing feel, so... So you could do that. Couldn't pick out the bass on Metallica, you say? So it was And Justice for All. Yeah, I thank you, Richard, for the recommendation. I do need to pick up a mouse, so that is something I will do. I will do that tomorrow. See what I did there? I held the pitch. I know the note I'm looking for. Ba-da-ba-da. I'm going to go for triplet here. Ba, 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 ba. Stays on the same string. Ba, da, da, da. Ba, da, da, da. Ba, da, da, da. Stupid. This mouse is driving me insane. Ba ba. Ba da 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 da. That one too. Anything but razor for anything. Well, I've learned that the hard way. Experience, Chris. You have to learn a million metal bass lines, and then you start to get better at hearing that particular thing. I'd say for accidentals, depending on the harmony for spelling, yeah. But for readability, I'd go for sharp, flat. For one line, I'd go for natural notes when possible. Even to say F flat is that. Yeah, I'd agree with that. Thanks so much, Levi. Remember you from the Racer Export. Yeah. You just got to keep at it, man. Speaking of the Racer Export, you know, I made reference to this the other day when I streamed, well, yesterday. Mitch, M. Ducran from the Racer Export, he was a transcriber, and he was actually a big influence on taking things seriously. Oh, I can't believe I forgot this as part of my story to becoming a transcriber. I started to get to know people as well when on the Racer X forums, Brian Hsu, who is now a patron of mine and was watching the stream yesterday, killer player, go and check him out, wanted to do a Racer X forum jam. Was it? It was either Brian or it's Paolo. It probably wasn't Brian actually, but he was involved. He wanted to do the jam over the Sir Mega Jam. So I was like, cool, I don't really know how to play over this type of stuff, so I'll just transcribe all of the solos on the Sir Mega Jam. And I reached out to Martin Miller when I'd done them all. I was like, dude, I've done all of these transcriptions. Do you want to sell them? That's how I got to know Martin Miller. So there you go. Now we go into the classic jack. Is he starting there? What's he play there? That makes sense. Now I put this in as a grouping of five, even though it's really 3/16 and 2/32. Because we just want to be able to learn it. We want to understand his line, and that's a good way of practicing that slowly. Yeah, man, Mitch. You've been in a lot of our channels that have live chat, and it's frustrating. Keep asking questions, they get ignored. Dude, I read all comments, and I do my best to respond to them if I can. I'm transcribing Jack Gardiner. Are you unfamiliar with Jack? It is Jack Gardiner, yeah. What the fuck does he play? Can't even click and drag. Right, should we check it so far? Jack Gardiner is a phenomenal player. Phenomenal player. I'm here in C sharp. Are we talking this one? Is that C sharp? It's not a C sharp, it's a B. Talking out my ass. Ba 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 ba. Right, let's do a playback just so you can, you know, hear how this will sound when it's played along with Jack. We just get a tempo. 65 BPM. Hopefully that works. Sorry. It's 130. Had it half speed. I was like, 65? That doesn't sound right. Okay, so in theory, now, when I go here and go, we should be able to hit this and go, 1, 2, 3, 4. Am I out of time there? So it's a little bit faster than that. Let's go 1, 3, 2. Fucking double click is driving me insane. Couldn't have gone much better than that, right? What I want to do is I'm going to do that again. I'm just going to really boost the volume of this. Shut up. Now let's hear the two of them so you can really hear it. This is the part I didn't want to have to transcribe. So what's going on? How much do I love the Michael Romeo album? You know, I only listened to it a couple of times, and it was good. It was good, but it wasn't. It didn't grab me like a Symphony X album would grab me. You know, Jack doesn't have a band. He plays with various other. He does a lot of session work, like he toured with Stu Ham, etc. He needs to hurry up and put a fucking album out. I'll push him to do that. Not that he'll listen to me. You can't sync a guitar pro to transcribe. I've got very good at doing that. Right, should I take a break? Yeah, let's take a break. Let's bring myself back up, because I know I'm just going to have to head on and transcribe the bit that I really don't want to have to bloody do. So. In fact, let's take a break to say thank you to my supporters over on Patreon. They bring a stream to like this to you. You know, this is happening because of them. Though saying that, you know, your tuning in to this and your interaction in the comments section encourages me to keep doing these. So thank you very much. I'll talk about what I don't like transcribing there in a second, Robert. It's a rhythmic thing that he does, very easy to play, very difficult to write down. And it may be enough for me to go, fuck it, I'll do this tomorrow, because it is 2 o'clock in the morning here. So big thank you to my supporters over on Patreon. Link in the description if you want to support me there. You can also check me out on Amazon, check out one of my books, and let me know how you get on with them. Obviously very proud of all of them. My favourite, someone asked me this last time, it's probably 100 Country Licks for Guitar. I'm very proud of how well that one turned out, because it's so much more than just a country book. It's got the 100... Yeah, fuck it, why don't I play it? It's got the 100 licks that you'd expect, but then there's all these other chapters on, you know, being able to use this stuff in real contexts. And if I go... Let me see if I can find the audio. 100 licks. And then I go... Audio, maybe? That would make sense, wouldn't it? And I go... which one is it? There's two tracks. Be this one? That would be this one, wouldn't it? Same solo played twice. Quite why I thought that much compression was necessary is beyond my knowledge. And also in the country guitar soloing techniques, there is another similarly tricky solo that I composed for that. That sounds like this. Is it this one? You get the idea. So lots of licks to learn in those books. And also, go and grab yourself a TTM shirt. Because when Lance Benedict calls you an extortionist, you damn sure you're going to market that thing. Links in the description. Right, let me check those comments to see if anyone has anything to ask, and I'll see if I can be bothered to do more of this damn transcription. Where are you guys? You're over here somewhere. There you are. Cool. Oh, that's it. So where did you get that Custom Symphony X New Mythology book that I showed on the stream? So though that was another reason why I decided I wanted to be a transcriber. I bought some Symphony X tab books on eBay, and when they turned up, they weren't official. They were custom made. Somebody had transcribed them and printed them themselves. And they were reasonably good. I wouldn't say they're flawlessly accurate, but they were pretty cool. And looking at those and thinking to my and seeing them and thinking to myself, oh, wow, you know, I could do this myself. I could just transcribe stuff myself. So they were very influencing. Influential. That's the word I'm looking for. Nice one, Levy. Keep it clean. Thank you very much. Bought the 100 Licks book. It's cool. Thank you very much. Reminds you of Brad Paisley. Big influence on me. Yeah, Sammy's cheesy country playing, isn't it? But I dig that type of thing. Would I do a song from the new Scott Henderson CD or maybe Lee Ritter's Sessions? I mean, from a private transcription perspective, yes, if you hit me up and wanted either of those, I would absolutely do them. I can't do things like that on my YouTube because you immediately get a copyright strike if you do things like that. In fact, I got a strike on the video that the stream I did yesterday because I streamed my own video of me playing the Crossroads guitar thing, all the slide parts. And because there's Steve Vai playing his thing in there, it immediately got claimed. So that video was... Well, not a loss, but didn't do what I wanted it to, which is a shit ton of views and high engagement. And when you have a claim on a video like that, YouTube just kind of throttles engagement, which is a shame. So yeah, what's going on Facebook? Good for you, Tim. Fucking mouse! Good point. Chris points out that he does have one of those funny headless guitars like most of the fakers. So, it's entirely possible. It's Jack's laugh that kills me. Oh, yeah, Jack's the best. Right, what have we got going on? You're welcome, Upside Down. Thank you very much for all of your support. Timothy, hello from Chicago, from the Windy City. Worst official transcription material you've seen? That is a great question. Some of the old Engbase songbooks are dreadful. The Japanese ones are great, though. So that's what I go to immediately. I go to the Malmsteen ones, and that's because... The notes tend to be right in them, you know, but the fingerings for them tend to be off because nobody knew that without seeing him play, a transcriber wasn't to know that he played his ideas up and down strings, single strings, rather than moving across the strings. So if you look at like the Wolf Marshall transcriptions, he tends to do a lot of the sequences across strings, which as we know is wrong. So that jumps to me. As being an example, but the one that sticks in my mind is actually the tab book for Greg Howe's Introspection. He released that as an official tab book, and it's fucking awful. It is really bad, which is fine. Like, bad tab books exist. I've seen many of them in my time, but the reason it bugs me in particular is because, you know, part of the marketing for that book is this book is meticulously edited by Greg and meticulously checked by Greg. And it's just not true. Like, it just wasn't meticulously checked by Greg. And I'm not going to say he doesn't care. I've spoke with Greg about putting out a book before, and like, he just wasn't willing to pay me a fair rate, so we didn't do anything together. And that just seems bizarre to me, because that album, Introspection, is one that you just take it seriously, man, because your fans take that album really seriously. It should be as accurate as humanly possible, right? So that one. On the flip side, when you put of sucks copyright system, YouTuber's horror idea. On the flip side, talking about amazing transcription books, my favourite one, not that you asked, is Bumblefoot's tab book for The Adventures of Bumblefoot, because he did all of that himself. It's completely spot on, and it's got all of the annotations necessary, including things like, you know, play with a battery attached to the guitar with an elastic band over the 27th fret, etc. Like, you use a battery as a slide. There's all manner of, like, additional bits of information in there that tell you how he achieved the sounds. And I like that. I like those kind of really detailed transcriptions that you see. So, yeah. Again, not that you asked, but that's the answer to the question that nobody asked. Let me listen to this Jack thing, see if I can be bothered. I'll explain the issue with this, right? I might change my mind as soon as I hear it, right? Where are we up to? We're up to bar 20. Fucking double click. It's the fact that he plays this rhythmic motif, this idea. Ba-da-da, ba-da, ba-da, ba-da-da, ba-da-da. And he just repeats it at will. It's not like he's playing ba-da, 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 ba-da-da, or ba-da, ba-da-da, ba-da-da, ba-da-da. It's ba-da, ba-da-da, ba-da, ba-da-da, ba-da-da. It's the same motif but placed in different places in the bar. And notating stuff like that is a fucker. There was a link in the description, Chris, to my band, Hellcat Molly, on Bandcamp. I'm going to be doing a reissue of those two albums this coming month, though, so keep your eyes peeled for that. And there is a store page for my books. You just go to Amazon and look for Levi Clay. All of my books are manufactured by Amazon. So, time is super loose, and it's a fucker to write that stuff down, isn't it? I'm sure some of those old tab books were done by keyboard players. Wouldn't surprise me at all, man. Would not surprise me at all. Here's a good question from Ryan. Am I going to hang the guitars on that back wall to fill it out? I'm going to do more than that. So I'm going to be alternating between GIK sound-absorbing panels. Big black panel, guitar, panel, guitar, panel, guitar. So we're going to fill that wall. I'm going to do the same on that wall. I'm going to do the same on that wall. And I'm just putting sound panels on the wall behind me, because I've got a lot of guitars to hang up. Too many damn guitars. Oh, no, fuck it. I'm going to log off, guys. I've been streaming for over 2 hours. And again, I did this for fun. I transcribed the Jack thing for fun, because it is fun. Like, don't get me wrong, it is fun. I did enjoy this. But I have actual fucking jobs that I need to do that have been paid for. So I need to... In fact, let's take a quick look. This is what I should really be doing this evening. Not that. This. We'll be right back. I'll get that transcribed for Martin Miller for his Patreon page. So we will get that done. Anyway, any final questions before I log off and maybe get an early night? That's Martin Miller, Chris. Martin Miller. He has a signature guitar with Ibanez. He's German. He's one of the best people I know. Pretty good guitar player too. He was in the stream earlier on. He was commenting earlier on. Martin is a top dude. Top dude. That's he does these band session things. That was with Paul Gilbert. So you can see Paul Gilbert. Well, you can't because I've closed the video down. But Paul Gilbert is there. He's done some really cool ones with Andy Timmons and Josh Smith. And damn, who else has he done those with? Huh. People. Lots of people. So any closing comments? Anything that people want to ask? I'm happy to answer while I am still here. Obviously, I can't answer if I'm not here. Oh shit, Martin Miller just crossed 200,000 subscribers on YouTube. So his channel's a lot bigger than fucking 6 times bigger than mine. Like 8 times bigger than mine. I guess I could check my YouTube comments as well. Let's do a live response. My TTM video seems to be popular again, which is funny, so... Well, here's a stupid comment on my A432Hz. I don't believe in all that spirit bullshit, but I can tell you that 432Hz is more in harmony with your voice when singing. All right. No interesting comments for me to deal with. Demonetizing my Guitar Souls videos. For anyone that hasn't gone and listened to the latest episode of the Guitar Souls podcast, I would encourage you to do so. Mike is on form, hilarious in it. Like I was absolutely buckled listening to him go on a rant about having a fight with Lance Benedict. good times. There's another $2 from Connor. Thank you very much, man. Chris, I could list off 100 guys that you don't know that are all awesome, and that's the beauty of music, right? I bet you could list 100 guys that I don't know that are also awesome. How long have I been growing this beard? That's a good question. Don't know. Watching concrete dry. No worries, bro. If you could hurry up and move back home, though, that'd be great. Thank you. Okay. Right, that's me gone. So, comment. Relatively new to my channel, but you're English living in Scotland. That is absolutely correct, Ryan. Big thanks to Patreon supporters. Thank you very much, guys. You can check me out in the ICW main event. Yeah. You can check me out in the on Patreon in the link in the description. You can support me for as little as $1, and every little penny is appreciated. You can also head on over to Amazon, look for Levi Clay. You will find my books. Please do. I appreciate your love and support over there. They pay the bills, so that's always good. And look for the TTM shirt in the description as well. I have enjoyed your company this evening. Much love. Thank you very much. And I will see you for another live stream soon. Probably not tomorrow, though. I probably shouldn't do this every night or you'll get bored of me. Right. Much love. Talk soon. Bye.